I am an intern and I was recording this just so I can review it. So if you're not like okay with your face being in the picture because I'm trying all kinds of angles, let me know because it's getting like this angle right here. Are y'all okay with that? Okay, super. All right. So let's start off with a good story. This is Interrupting Chicken. Who knows David Ezra Stein? As you work through, yes, if you work through your authors today, this is where the water put on your list. All right, Interrupting Chicken. Did I know it already? Oh, great. I love to introduce a new book. It was Bedtime for the Little Red Chicken. Okay, my little chicken, said the papa.
Are y'all all ready to go to sleep?
Yes, papa, but you forgot something.
Well, what's that, asked papa?
A bedtime story.
All right, said papa, I'll read you one of your favorites. And of course, you're not going to interrupt the story tonight, are you?
Oh, then, papa, I'm good.
So the story is Hansel and Gretel. And if you try this out on anybody, they may not know the story, all right? So you might want to have to do a little bit of background on the traditional stories. Unfortunately, folks don't know the traditional stories and traditional rhymes, and they're all the building blocks for the other readers. So introduce your kiddos to the 398.2s of the library, because those books have been around a while for a reason. All right. Hansel and Gretel were very hungry, so deep in the woods, they found the house they intended. Nibble, 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 they began to eat the house. Until the old woman who lived there came out and said, "Oh, what lovely children, why don't you come inside?" And they were just about to follow her when, "I just a little red chicken," and she said, "Don't go and see the witch." So Hansel and Gretel did.
Chicken? Interrupting the story. Try not to get so lost.
I'm sorry, Papa, but she really was a witch.
Well,
you're supposed to be relaxing so you can fall asleep.
Well, let's try another story. I'll be good.
Little Red Riding Hood. So take this basket of goodies to Grandma, said Little Red Riding Hood's mother, but don't stray from the path. The woods are full of danger. And Red Riding Hood skipped along through the deep woods. By and by, she met a wolf
who wished her good morning.
And she was about to answer him
when I'm just a little red chicken. And she said, "Don't talk to strangers." So Red Riding Hood began.
Chicken?
Yes, Papa?
You did it again. You interrupted two stories and you're not even sleepy.
I know, Papa. But he was a mean old wolf.
Yes, now get back into bed.
Okay, Papa. Let's tell one more little story, and I'll be good.
Chicken Little. Chicken Little was hit on the head by an acorn.
"The sky is falling," she thought. "She's about to run off and warn Goosey, Lucy, Ducky, Lucky, Henny, Penny, and everyone on the farm that the sky was falling."
Chicken.
Yes, Papa?
You did it again.
Oh, Papa, I could have had that little chicken get all upset over an acorn. Please read one more story, and I promise I'll fall asleep.
But Chicken, said Papa, we're out of stories.
Oh, no, Papa, I can't go to sleep without a story.
Then said Papa, darling, why don't you tell me a story?
Me? Tell a story?
Okay, Papa. Here we go.
Bedtime for Papa by Chicken. Once there was a little red chicken who put her papa to bed, and she read him all 100 stories, and she even tried to give him warm milk, but nothing worked. He stayed wide awake all night.
Papa? Good night, Papa. And the little chicken crawls in bed with a bat. And that's the end.
Yay!
And you got it right here on the shelf if you want to check it out and take it home with you today. All right, so interrupting chicken reminds me about the thing that we can do as educators to help our folks feel healthy and strong and confident and ready to learn is we need to keep them breathing. All right, we live in a world of interruptions. We live in a world of distractions. We live where we hear these notifications and our brain goes, dopamine, let's have a bet on people. You know, it's like rolling the dice every time you pick up your phone. Who's talking? Who like that? Who signed for internet? Who saw that? And who said this? And so we need to teach everyone to breathe. You will find that when you get into the field of education, that folks are going to come to you at all different levels. And so I want to think about that today. All the different ways the folks that you work with as students, how they'll be healthy or not. And I want to think about how the breath can be helpful and movement, gentle movements can be helpful, and strengthening movements can be helpful to your whole educational efforts. It'll land better, right? If you've got a healthy someone ready to learn right there in front of you. Everybody hold on to your belly, right? And then everybody say physical health.
Physical health.
Okay, your body is a container in which you're going to travel through this thing we call life, right? And so you want to get those miles out of it as fast as you can, right? And you want to take deep breaths to help yourself do that. So pull the air up your nose. And then feel that belly expand with air and then let it go. Now, this is really hard to do because our whole life long we've been told to
hold in the belly, right? You know, make sure you.
No, y'all breathe. Put your belly, get my hands here, and pretend you're the dog on the hot summer day and breathe over that tongue. Where do you feel something moving? You may not, and that's okay. You've got to practice on these things, right? And it's okay if the folks you work with don't feel it at first, but you practice it. That's the diaphragm. There's that muscle in your body that separates all the breathing parts of you from the eating parts of you. It's the ceiling for all the eating parts. It's the basement for the breathing. And you want to breathe deeply. You know, we use just the tops of our lungs all day when I speak metaphorically, just shallow breathing. If you ever watch Little One, a little tiny brand new person on the earth, what you see their bellies go up and down, right? And that's, we breathe well, and then life changes how we do things. Distractions and interruptions, and we begin to be interrupters ourselves, right? So big breath in through the nose, and then out through the mouth or nose. This toy is a great way to teach little folks and tall folks about breathing in and breathing out and filling up the body with air. This is called the Hoberman Spear, or we call it a breathing bomb. But if you can start every day, or every lesson, or every once, I once knew about Will Moody with this principal out at he would get on the announcements that he was going to school counselor. And he'd get on the announcements and he would always say, before he said anything, I said, everybody stop and take a deep breath. Thank you, Will Moody, right? If the principal is leading that way, it's awesome because everybody takes a big deep breath. And physiologically in your body, you calm. Yeah. Right? You get out of that sympathetic mode of fight, flight, on, and you get into that thinking mode, and that is called feed and breathe. Digestion works, everything's gonna work better. Rest and digest is sometimes called. It's when the healing happens, right? Your body can go to work and do what it's designed to do with the breath. Right? So everybody's in charge of physical health. Physical health. Hold on to your bellies. Alright? Now put your hand on your heart and think about being in charge of your emotional. Your kids, tall or small, whoever, wherever you land in the kitchen, the kids that you work with are going to come with all kinds of feelings. All right, now say this with me. All the feelings are valid. All the feelings are valid. We grow up in a world that says, don't cry, don't cry. It's okay, don't cry, right? Cry! Cry out loud, cry! Right? As I worked as a teacher. I worked as a library lady. I worked as a school counselor in my public education career for the 30 years that I was gifted to and privileged to work in education. And as a school counselor, teachers would call me and say, he's crying. I'm like, some illustrations by Henry Cole, and in Surfer Chick, she wants to be just like her dad. And he is the surfer legend in the town, right? So he goes out and he buys her a pink skateboard that's just like her favorite color, right? And I love that the end papers in the hardback are pink, all right? So Chick and her dad got a shiny new board. It was just the right size and a pink Chick adored. Now she gets on there and tries to start surfing. And just like all the new things that you don't teach the people that you love and appreciate and like just feel one day, all right, she has a hard time. All right, she climbed on her board to learn how to paddle, but what happened next was a foul-tempered battle. And Dad tried to encourage her and tell her exactly how to get her done. And man, this is my favorite part here. She wipes out, right? And it says, a breaker rose that ruffled her feathers and tangled her toes. That's going to happen 3 times before you get to the next thing, right? Things are going to happen that are challenging and difficult. You're going to get angry. You're going to get sad. And when it happens, it's okay. Allow space. So what she does is she sits on the beach for a while so she can gather herself. And we need to do a little more of that sitting and being still and quiet. And how do we get that done? We stop and we take some deep breaths. All right, breath up the nose. And out the nose or the mouth. So you can self-regulate and manage your emotions well with the deep breaths. So, create you some butterflies, right? Like, I mean, it's in your students. Or some folks that can breathe like an umbrella. So breath in and reach your arms up. And exhale and reach your arms down. Yeah, go ahead and do it. It feels good. Somebody told me a couple of weeks ago that there is something, again, with those neurochemicals in your brain. Those neurochemicals in your brain that when you reach your arms up over your head, you really create some happy. All right? So get them stretched and grit them in. Don't we sit too much? So breathe those wings up and breathe those wings down, and you'll take care of your emotional health as well. Emotions and the energy that you have is like water come out of a faucet, and you can either turn it on and full blast, right? No good, not appropriate. Or you can turn it not too much and it's trickle. So you can use the breath to help with the regulation, right? The control, and oh my mercy, if that's the one thing you lead your people with, is control. You will have given them more than a lot of people that run our world right now. Yeah? A lot of the leaders and a lot of the folks that kids are looking up to or students are looking up to now, they're not modeling what we need. And you need to model it, right? When you feel anger, when you have big emotion in the classroom, you need to stop and breathe. And you need to say, hey, you know what? I have a big feeling right now. Right now is not the time for us to talk about this because I don't need to speak from this feeling. I need to sit with it. I need to breathe. And then let's talk about this one, or let's talk about making an appointment. Don't leave somebody hanging, but say, I want to get back on this. This is important. But not for right now. We need to take a break. Right? So use the emotion as a messenger and make it okay when your kiddos get angry. And don't try to fix it. All right, we're fixers, right? We want our kids to grow and our tall and small students. We want them all to be strong. Don't fix it. That's not the way to help them and empower them, right? Let them figure out the ways to work through those difficult things that they got. And they got some difficult things that they bring to the table, right? All right, the next thing you're tired of is mental health, all right? But hold on to your noggin, all right? I'm tired of what I mean, all right? So mental health is huge. We take a lot of... Mental health is huge. We when we see somebody with a band-aid or a cast, we're quick to be empathetic or, you know, what's happening? You know, are you okay? But when people have difficulties between their ears, we don't have as much culturally, we don't have as much patience, or we don't have as much empathy, or we're just like over it. Come on, right? The depression. big old deep breath, right? And so hold a flower in your hand, right? Hold a candle in the other hand, and you're using your imagination where you breathe in and smell the beautiful scent of that flower. And when you breathe out, gently blow out. Breath in and breath out. And you can take care and have clarity of mind, be more ready to learn when you've taken a deep breath. You can take care of what's happening between your ears as well. All right, so everybody say physical health.
Physical health.
Emotional health.
Mental health.
All right, now we're ready for relational health. So take your palms together, slide your fingers so that you can hook the tops of the fingers, right, together, and then pull. Now, as you pull, pull the shoulder blades together. Relax the shoulder. We have them up here a lot, the tongs, right? But they're not designed to be there. You need them lower. And if you don't do anything but just teach people shoulder rolls, right? Just do some shoulder rolls that you take that deep breath and you start to relax. And you start the next thing that you're doing, right? You don't need to teach people to forward roll. We do that all day. We have a computer, we have a steering wheel, we have a meal, we're over. We watch people, they walk around on this and things, right? Forehead syndrome, got the text of the normal Thursday day. So we need to teach people that good posture, and we need to teach people to roll their shoulders back and up and down. And we need to remember that the relationships that we have are critical for how we show up every day, how it feels in your body. You can have an argument with somebody, and you may then end up having like a headache or a backache or something like that. It's not necessarily that you're having a hurt there. It's that emotion, that relationship, that disagreement, the issues and the tissues, right? And it's showing up in your body, but it's really something that you need to work out with the person that you're having this agreement. Don't post it on TikTok and the Twitter and all that. But anyway, whatever the social media platform of your choice. And I use Facebook, and I shouldn't share that one, isn't it? But anyway, don't put it there. Go to the person that you have the disagreement with, right? Because you can't solve it any other way. And you may not feel better until you get done, when you get a warm peace about whatever the disagreement is. So here is
everyone ready for more fun?
And this is dedicated to my pet and friend, Valerie Bird. We did this one together when we did a Pocky Reading Express. I got the privilege of hanging out with Pocky and Miss Bird Ford. All right, so Plop, is everyone ready for fun? So the cows say it's
time to jump up and down, everyone, up and down on chicken sofa.
Alright, so if you're working depending on your audience, always know your crowd, right? But you may have some folks that can jump, right? Maybe you do that part of the story. Now, wait a minute, says the chicken. Yes, I'm jumping on my sofa.
Oh, okay,
chicken, says the cow. Oh,
we won't jump
on your sofa anymore. Alright, so here you can have some talk of some language. You can think about verbs, right, as you play with this book. Is everyone ready for more book?
Chicken sofa.
Oh, now people think I'm jumping. Yes, you're wiggling on my sofa. sleep and to put the phone away or the tablet away or not have that electronic device going on that long, right? When I was in education, we were all about, let's check and make sure the kiddos don't have, I guess it's pretty obvious, I work most of my group in the military, but I mean, you know, this is forever, right? We talked about the TV being in the bedroom. Well, now we've got devices that are way worse than the TV in the bedroom ever was. And we got kiddos that are doing those things all night long without supervision, and they go in all these places and they tell me all these things that they see on YouTube, and I'm thinking, oh, I don't even want to see that, right? And that's the biggest problem. We were tired. We were so tired. We don't have folks all sleep in class, right? And so encourage good rest. It seems so basic, but truly, breathing and resting are the two things that you walk away out of here today. And as you continue as a learner yourself, our school system, right, doesn't really create us the opportunity to practice great self-care habits. It's about reduce deadline. Oh, you gotta get all, you know, stay up all night. Well, now, here I am back in college, and I'm at 55, so this is like, you know,
what's over there, you guys?
And one of my friends said, I stay up all night to get that project done. And I said, see,
were you open to that?
I do, but I was your age, and I did it, and I got through. You know, sometimes pulling that all night, I can't do that. That's not a long-term kind of goal, right? And the plus, y'all, there's research now that shows when you sleep and you have those sleep cycles, your body is doing things like taking out the trash in your mind. And don't rest well when you're younger. They connected it now to the onset of dementia at earlier age. All right? So you do what you can, right, to take care of yourself so that you can keep on getting it. Because remember, the first thing he said is you want to get the most miles out of your car. All right? You want to be able to get to these kids. And we need to go out there doing what you're called to do to serve children and to students of all ages. We need you. Education needs you to keep it going on in a good way. In a healthy way. So because people can learn all that they can learn. All right, so you're in charge of your physical health. You're in charge of your emotional health, your mental health, your relational health. And then I'm going to just slide up and do prayer hands, also called namaste hands in yoga. And there is spirit health, right? Spiritual health. And that doesn't mean that you need to go to church, right? But that means that people feel connected and feel purpose and feel joy. That's a light, right? A light that shines. And although we can't speak to that too much, you know, in what we do every day as educators, it is something that we need to be aware of. All right, hold your hands out. You'll be in charge of creating students that think and are problem solvers and collaborators, because you don't even have one iota of an idea about what kind of job they might have one day, because we don't even know that other jobs that are out there to be had, right? They're creating those kind of things all the time. So you're creating thinkers. And you're doing that with creating healthy students that can breathe and read and discuss and ponder and ask lots and lots and lots of questions. All right, men, rub your fingers together. That's financial health. All right, now, that for you is to manage that money as best you can, right? And kids are going to come to you of all ages, but they don't really have much to be in charge of about the wealth of their families. But we need to be tune into. And who's the lady that does all the stuff on poverty? It's Ruby somebody.
Oh, I can't remember.
Okay, but there's research out there, yeah, that reminds you when somebody comes from a different background than what you're familiar with, to be aware that their decisions and choices and the behaviors are connected to that economic level, the class level. So, for example, he went to the fair. And you saw tons of people at the fair, right? Now, did anybody look at a family and go, how in the world is that family here financially? I'm looking at this family that had all these children, and I'm like, I don't care if I pay $20 or $15 if you did it online per person in the family. And then they ride and ride, and then they got to eat food there, right? Oh, no. But in Ruby's research, I can't call her last name. Okay. Hey, and what's your book? Do you remember from the John? I know it's Brandon Yellen. I just love it when it comes to the library. It's like Brandon Yellen. matter. All right, so we're in charge of helping our folks feel physical health, all right? Everybody say whatever you admit, emotional health, mental health, relational health, spiritual health, vocational health, financial health, and then we bring the palms, heels of the hands together rather, the length of the fingers, the thumbs, and this is going to be a flower, right? We're kind of creating the flower, but we're going to think about environment, and we're going to think about environmental factors and the health that folks come to the classroom with. And is anybody familiar with Nadine Burke Harris's The Deepest Well and the idea of ACEs? Adverse childhood, what's the name? Effects. Adverse childhood effects, I think.
Have you guys talked about that in your classes yet? ACEs and like trauma-informed.
So y'all,
yeah,
really that good is good stuff to know because we all have trauma. Now, if you live through COVID, you got trauma. But it's the things that's talking about if you are a child of a divorced family, if you have experienced a death in the last blah, 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 if you grew up around fighting and a lot of harsh words and altercations, you carry that again. The body keeps the score. Anybody know Bessel van? Yes, yes, yes. Amen, sister. Good stuff. Because people that came back, Bessel van der Kolk did his research on people that came back from Vietnam. They could not assimilate, right? We call it now post-traumatic stress disorder, right? So, bye, y'all. The idea is that we know that about our people, okay? All right, so we're in charge of our, and to be attentive to that. And so anytime I've done trauma-informed practices, and it's a passion of mine, because I myself was involved in a car accident as a child. My sister died in an accident, and I did not know that was a trauma in my life. And I grew up being a people pleaser, trying to make sure everything was just right. And through therapy, I learned that's a part of trauma because if you as a child think everything is just right, if I do my best, then there will never be a bad or terrible thing happening again. You know, as a developmentally, that's not true, but as a child, you can't just imagine that and you're thinking like that could just happen, right? You have to explain, you have to try to find your way, navigate it. And so I'm able as an adult now because I can kind of unwind the right? So knowing that and practicing good hospitality with folks, if somebody needs to be closer to a door, let them be near a door, right? If somebody isn't comfortable with something you're doing, give them lots of options. So there's lots of ways to get something done. Just be thoughtful and attentive because people don't remember how you make them feel more than anything you ever taught. And you think about your favorite teachers, right? The reason probably you're sitting in this room, I don't want to be like Miss So-and-so or Mr. So, right? You know, those people make you feel loved and valued and appreciated and that they understood. And that comes down to our environment, right? Last one that we'll think about today is cultural health. We live in a world of polarization. Everybody's on this side or that side, nobody in between. When actually things are so fluid, things are so not binary, right? We know that this is probably an age too. So feel the fingertips really connect with one another. This is like almost creating a world with your hands. This is something when you teach people to breathe, you can work this way with your fingers. And this is another way to help you be in this moment, help you be more confident, help you to have clearer thinking. All right, and then take your fingertips and fingers interlace them, one thumb on top of the other, and then draw some side weight of your age with your hands, working your wrists, and it's all got to come together right now, right? And then I'll see if you can take back your eight and draw it backwards. And if it blows your mind, that's okay. Good stuff. It'll be girl happening. All right, now take your hand and then take the thumb on top and hold the fingers and say, oh, that feels beautiful. Right? Does it? Yeah, okay, yeah. And do that if you're a little, if you end up working with little people and you crisscross with the legs, try to do it opposite. They might not have to know how to do a pattern yet, but you'll start to feel like, ooh, well, that's the imbalances that you got, right? And so we can do these things to try to help ourselves right shift. All right, so you can work your feet. So I'll let it come out there and you can rewind it. And everybody remind me, we as a teacher, we're in charge of people's mastery and physical health.
Emotional health, mental health, relational health, spiritual health, albeit like maybe just, you know, suddenly, or, you know, one of those that's clear but it's quiet. Vocational health, financial health, environmental health, cultural health, and bringing it on to that. All right, so today for Grins and Giggles, you have an opportunity to make a pinwheel. So you'll need four things, and there's a station there and a station here. You need a straw, you need a colorful doobrobby, and then you need a yellow piece and a red piece. So if you quickly can get you, because I know we have 20 more minutes, right? Is that right, Miss Val?
Good.
All right, get you a color you can live with, a red thing, a yellow thing. One blue bobby.
Yes.
One blue bobby. You need four things when you're through. Pink, yellow, and red. One of those.
Okay.
Yeah, one. You need four things. Pink, yellow, red, and the colorful blue bobby. Which I'm so sorry that I have such a great vocabulary. I use that as an inner dooflotchy or doopicky, or you may have other ways that you
like it.
But one of my friends at seminary, she said, "You got me saying blue blobby."
It's like an instant, right? Whatever you get, that's always a word. And we do a common attraction, education, a lot of your kids, like your brain.
Clockwise.
paper out if you understand it. You getting it? And y'all are good to go. Yeah. You are getting it. You getting it? So you're going like, so it'll be the next thing, and you go in, and you might have to pick it up and over it.
Do you start with this one?
It doesn't matter, you're just going around in a circle. Your third one is your mental health. Your fourth one is your relational health, right? Oh yeah, you got it! Your fifth one is your About why it's so important to encourage health and all the ways that you can encourage it. You will be with your students more than their parents are. Right? You have an amazing opportunity to make a difference in the life of someone as a teacher. And it is going to be a challenge because, like Ms. Burford said, and like you know, you are entering into such a political arena. There's people trying to tell you what you can and you can't teach, and they have never stepped into an education class ever, right? And there are people that are saying you're not going to have communication with the Professional Association for Librarians because they think they know more, because the librarians are woke, right? You're entering into a difficult field, but a most rewarding and most necessary, and I will keep you in my heart because it's the work that makes everything else happen, y'all. It's how we have doctors, it's how we have lawyers, it's how we have people that are the leaders in government, it's how we have counselors, it's how we have everybody. It comes back to you teaching them history in high school or preschool about sharing and caring, right? You teach them to breathe. If you give them those tools, they can think critically, they can be creative, they can be collaborative, and they can be the folks that we need them to be to do the job that they are designed to do in the world like nobody else can get done. The rate of people taking their lives will go down if we do our job well. We can't do everything, but we can make a difference for one. Yeah? One morning, a man walked along a beach covered with thousands of starfish that had washed up during a storm. And now they lay dying in the sun, and he saw a young girl picking up the starfish one by one, tossing them into the sea. And as he approached her, he couldn't help but ask, well, why bother? There are too many of them. You won't make a difference. She picked up another sea star is the correct word, right? And tossed it into the water, and she turned to that man, and she said, I made a difference for that one because by no willings. Because a man named Ludwig wrote beautiful music, a man named Franz was inspired to create his own. Because many years later, people wanted to hear Franz's beautiful music, they formed an orchestra. And because a man had practiced since he was a kid, he was asked to join. Because a woman studying night and day, she too was asked to play. And because many others loved and practiced their instruments, there were enough musicians. Because someone created a poster about Franz's music, tickets were sold. And because the train conductor stopped the train at the Grand Concert Hall, the orchestra conductor Because the orchestra librarian had copies of the score, the orchestra rehearsed. And because the workers checked the lights and the sinks and swept the floors, the grand hall was ready. Because the time had come, the ushers opened the door, and because someone's uncle had caught a cold, someone's aunt had an extra ticket for someone. Because the usher helped the aunt and her special guest, they found their seats. And because everyone was there to hear beautiful music, it was quiet. There's the orchestra that you can't see because the picture's too small. From where you're sitting, yay for document cameras and the education these days. There's the beautiful music and how you can listen to it all. In row C, C14, sat the girl with the uncle's ticket. And she heard the beautiful music written by the man named Franz, and it changed her. The girl was changed. And from that moment on, the girl learned everything she could about music, because it fed her. And soon she started to write music too, because like Franz, the young woman had something to share. Over the time, the woman became very good because she had worked very hard. And one night, her music was discovered, because she also was lucky, and she was invited to perform her music at the Grand Concert Hall because so many people wanted to hear it. Her composition was dedicated to the uncle that was in row C, C14, because it was his ticket that brought her. And that night, someone else was changed. That you were designed to be. You make the world better like you can do, and you create folks, the opportunities for folks to do the same. Keep breathing, right? Keep finding that rhythm with your strength and your stretch and your flexibility, and keep getting my stress. Alright? Thank you for the chance to be here. If you write down something you learned today on your paper, I will be see when you have next class. Alright, so on Tuesday, Ms. Bridport will have these 6 note cards that are 6 pumpkins, and you can write somebody a note on Halloween Day that says, wishing you a happy, scary, spooky, fun, and wonderful Halloween, to remind them that all the ways you feel are valid, okay? And she'll have 6 folks from those ticket exit slips to know. If you will put your exit slip in this silly pumpkin on your way out, I appreciate it. Ms. Bridport, do you have any announcements or anything that you need to share?
Yeah. You guys are on Tuesday, because watch your